Chairman Cicilline, Ranking Member Sensenbrenner, Chairman Nadler, and distinguished members of the subcommittee, thank you for the opportunity to speak to you today, most notably on the Haven Act, which was recently introduced by Representatives McBath and Stubbe. Let me say up front that I'm not a bankruptcy expert, nor a lawyer, but I do have a long history of advocating for the military on consumer financial matters. I'm the daughter, wife, and mother of Army officers. As I lived a life of constant moves and more recently combat deployments, I saw the impact those events had on the finances of military personnel and their families. During the first year of the Iraq War, my husband's division went to war. I saw the family's financial challenges firsthand during that year, not just those of the active duty troops, but also families of the Guard and Reserve who came to our Family Assistance Center for help. I did what I could to help raise awareness with our federal and state legislators who visited. I also worked with local business leaders to include the Better Business Bureau, which led to the job that I held there for 6 years. Running BBB Military Line was an education for me on the fact that many scammers specifically target the military for their steady paycheck, which is often coupled with youth and financial inexperience. While I was at the BBB, we developed a number of free financial readiness workshops to provide in-person financial education for service members and their families. But while education is important, the sad truth is that in many cases, service members' finances are impacted by events that they cannot control. Deployments, shoddy loan servicing, inaccurate credit reporting, and the flouting of important consumer financial laws. So when I was offered the opportunity to head up the Office of Service Member Affairs at the newly formed Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, I jumped at the chance. I knew that the Bureau had the power to enforce consumer financial laws, and that to me was a vital part of protecting military families' hard-earned money. I ran that office for 6 years, and in that time we saw over $120 million returned to service members. Last year, I was asked to join an American Bankruptcy Institute task force on veterans and service members. One of its most immediate missions was to correct a glaring error in the Bankruptcy Code of 2005, language that effectively denied disabled veterans the protections it provided to all other disabled Americans. Under the 2005 law, judges could no longer decide what was a debtor's disposable income, but had to include virtually all income that the debtor received, except for three things: benefits received under the Social Security Act, payments to victims of war crimes, and payments to victims of terrorism. That first item is the problem. Civilians receive disability benefits from the Social Security Administration, but disabled service members and veterans do not. They get their disability benefits from the VA and from the Department of Defense. So by using specific language referencing the Social Security Act, Congress effectively denied those who had become disabled in the service of their country the rights given to others who had not served, and that is obviously not right. I cannot imagine that Congress intended this, but with their disability pensions counted, veterans may fail the means test and not qualify for Chapter 7 bankruptcy, which allows for a quick, fresh start. Instead, they must file for Chapter 13 with a 3 to 5 year payment plan that they must fund from their current monthly income, including their military disability pension. Surely Congress never intended that a military disability benefit should go into the pockets of creditors. The Haven Act will fix that problem. Let me also mention one other item you're considering. For National Guard and Reserve members, combat deployment, while a source of extra pay, could have a catastrophic impact on their civilian small business. But if they opted for bankruptcy, the means test counted their military special pay and allowances, even though they were no longer receiving them. That could make their income too high for bankruptcy. The National Guard and Reservist Debt Relief Act of 2008 fixed that issue, and today you're looking to extend it for another 4 years, an action I support. Our citizen soldiers who put on the uniform of our country should not be financially penalized for doing so. Ideally, no one should need to declare bankruptcy, but it happens, and at a higher rate for veterans. Many of them have disabilities that make it hard to earn a living wage, and that may limit their caregiver spouse, too. No veteran should face the added stress of pledging their disability benefits to creditors. You can eliminate the roadblocks and make it harder for them to discharge their debts. And I commend you, excuse me, for your efforts today. Thank you.